So, first a few words about me. I'm Peter Czanik from Hungary, SysLogNG evangelist at Belabit, the upstream developer of SysLogNG. I'm doing SysLogNG packaging, support and advocacy. Let me give you a quick overview what I will talk about you today. First of all, a quick introduction to SysLogNG and why is it good to be used in IoT devices. The roles of SysLogNG, a bit about log message formats, different kinds of devices where SysLogNG is used right now, and if time permits, I will also introduce you configuring SysLogNG a bit. So, first of all, what is logging? It's recording events on a computer or a device. In this case, I put an SSH login message, but it can be just about anything. And what is SysLogNG? It's an enhanced logging daemon with a strong focus on portability and central log collection. So why central logging? First of all, it's ease of use. You don't have to check tens or thousands of devices, but all logs are at a central location. It's also availability, so even if the sending machine is down, you can check the log messages and figure out what happened. And it's also security. If your end user device is hacked, you can figure out from the log messages what happened. And why to use SysLogNG on IoT devices? First of all, it's portable. It's mainly developed on x86, but it runs on ARM, Power, MIPS, whatever. I often run into new CPU architectures, what I have never heard about before, when I find SysLogNG packages on the internet. It's also small footprint, as most of it is written in C. You can use it to do complex processing and filtering of log messages. So you can make sure that only relevant log messages leave your devices and in a format which is ready to use. And best of all, you can use the same software everywhere, both on your devices and also on your central servers. So what are the main roles of SysLogNG? First of all, it's collecting messages. It can also process them, filter them, and at the end, either store them locally or forward to another destination. Let's talk about these in more depth. The first role is data collection, and I say data as it's not just system logs, but it can be any text data on your devices. So you can collect from platform-specific sources like Devlog, Journal, and so on, but also from network. It's a with our focus on central log collection, we support all of the different legacy and new syslog protocols over UDP, TCP, and encrypted connections. And you can collect messages from many other different sources like files, sockets, or even application output. The next, and in my opinion, the most important feature of SysLogNG is log processing. You can classify, normalize, and structure log messages with built-in parsers. And you can rewrite log messages. And you don't have to think about falsifying messages in this case, but, for example, anonymize log messages when required by compliance like GDPR and other requirements. You can reformat log messages. For example, if you need JSON messages on the collecting side, you can do that. And you can enrich log data using GeoIP or additional data based on the message content. The next role is filtering. It has two main uses. First of all, you can discard surplus log messages. For example, you don't want to forward all of the debug level messages, except if you are debugging an application. And the other one is message routing, making sure that the right messages reach the right destinations. For example, if you have authentication on your devices, it reaches the related analytics applications. There are many possibilities for filtering. It can be based on the message content, parameters. You can use many different comparisons and filtering functions. And best of all, any of these can be combined together using Boolean operators. The next role is, and final role is destinations. Traditionally, syslog was storing all of the log messages to flat files on the local file systems, but later on, network destinations were introduced, so you could collect syslog messages to a central location. Later on, many different destinations were introduced, SQL database, and in the past few years, we added different big data destinations like Hadoop, NoSQL databases, and messaging systems like Kafka or AMQP. Let's talk a few words about message formats. Normally, if you have a Linux device, log messages are often in a format of date, hostname, and some text. Here we are back to my favorite SSH login example, and you can see that it's an English sentence with some variable parts in it. It was designed to be read by humans, and it's quite good at it, but if you want to create reports from these messages, no two log messages are the same. I mean, messages from SSH are different from Apache, whatever, so it's quite difficult to create reports from log messages. The other key takeaway is that there is a solution for this problem. It's called structured logging. In this case, even instead of using free format text messages, you use name value pairs to represent events. For example, an SSH login message can be described as an application name, the username, source IP, source port, whatever. The good news is that SysLogNG was built around name value pairs right from the beginning, so other way it wouldn't be possible to do complex filtering and reformatting of log messages. So date, facility, priority, what, and so on are all based or represented in as name value pairs inside SysLogNG. And using parsers, you can turn unstructured and some structured data formats into name value pairs as well. So you can use those in filtering or just store parts of the name value pairs, which makes it a lot more flexible. There are parsers for some structured formats like CSV parser, JSON parser, key value parser, which is used in many firewall systems, for example. PatternDB is for unstructured log messages like the SSH login message. And if you want your, if you have a log message which is not covered by any of these, you can extend SysLogNG either writing something in C, or if Python is easier for you and you don't have a too high message rate, you can write your parser also in Python. So here comes a tricky question. Which SysLogNG version is the most used? What do you think? Here are some background data. Project started 20 years ago. Red Hat, our most widespread used Linux distro, has 3.5. and current version is 3.13. What do you think? Just a few guesses, which version is the most popular?
How about?
Sorry?
1.0?
Actually, it's 1.6. And we are coming to the topic of IoT devices. I don't think any of our version has a larger number of installation base, over 100 million devices sold as far as I'm concerned. So let's talk about devices. There are many consumer devices which have Syslogenji inside. I already mentioned Kindle, where anything you do in different parts of the application stack is logged by Syslogenji, and when there is an internet connection, data is sent to Amazon. You might not be quite happy about it, I guess. Another use is BMW i3 electronic car, where as far as I could understand from the configuration file, they use it for troubleshooting, and they use quite complex filters in their configuration. So they make sure that only relevant information is logged. Another set of devices are network attached storage and different network devices. Here, just a few names: Synology, Freenas, or the Turis Omnia, which you can see in another building here on display. Often you can access this only through the command line, and it was originally installed on these devices for troubleshooting and security purposes. But in some cases, they provide a nice, rich graphical user interface where you can configure logging and also query log messages. And some cases it can even be used as a central logging solution for a smaller network. I want to highlight here Synology, which became one of our contributors recently, providing quite nice memory related fixes. Another set of devices are industrial, like here are National Instrument real-time Linux devices, what I have on display. These are used for control and automation. On these devices, Syslogenji can be configured on the command line, but they provide rich graphical user interface to query log messages. They use it, they provide it as a troubleshooting tool, as the applications running on these devices are logging to syslog, Syslogenji, and this is how it's used. Another interesting use case, and unfortunately I cannot say names here, where Syslogenji is used both on the device and on the central logging side. We have uses in the car industry and also for smart metering, where many different kind of metrics are collected on these systems, and Syslogenji and the Syslog protocol is used to forward these information from the devices to a central location where data is stored to different big data destinations. I want to talk a few words about configuring Syslogenji, and my first advice is don't panic. As Syslogenji configuration is simple and logical, even if it looks difficult at first sight, and often also for the second sight. It has a pipeline model. There are many different building blocks like source, destination, filters, parsers, and so on. And all of these are connected together into a pipeline using log statements at the end. Let me quickly drive you through about a typical configuration. It starts with some global settings like version number of syslog.ng. So you can include other configuration files, set some global variables, and many of these can be overridden in later parts of the configuration. Here we define some sources. The upper one is for local log sources. Using system, you can hide away differences between different platforms. At the bottom, there is a network source defined. Here are some destinations. At the top one is a simple one for collecting var log messages in a flat file. The other one is for Elasticsearch, where you can define an index name, cluster name, and a template what data to send to Elasticsearch. Here we define some filters and parsers, a simple one. In the middle of the screen, you see a long list of filter functions combined using Boolean operators. And at the bottom one, you see loading a database for message parsing. And here is the heart of the configuration, where all of these building blocks are connected together. The first one is for var log messages. It's simple, just source and filter and the destination. The next one is a bit more complex. Here we use multiple sources, filter the collected messages, parse the rest, and finally store it into Elasticsearch. And here is a screenshot from Kibana, where you can see results from message parsing the different parts on this dashboard. You can also anonymize log messages, which is becoming more and more important, especially here in Europe. But not only here, for example, if you think about credit making sure that no credit card numbers are leaking. There are multiple ways to find these informations, and you can also solve that you not just find sensitive information, but also override it, and not just simple with constant value, but with a hash of the original information. So you can use the data for analytics without leaking sensitive information. Here is a nice map. This is this was created using a small tourism router, which I have connection attempts from all parts of the world, and IP address converted using GeoIP to geographical location. Here is the configuration. If you are interested, my presentation with all of this configuration is up on the FOSDEM site. So what is new in syslog.ng in recent releases? Disk-based buffering, making sure that even if you don't have a stable network connection, there are no messages lost. You can do generic correlation using the grouping by filter from all of the different. You can parse. You can use results from all of the different parsers in syslog.ng. The Python parser was added recently. You can use the REST API for Elasticsearch, use HTTP destination. For example, if you send data from IoT devices to Splunk. It's a typical use case. You have wildcard file source now, and as I mentioned, quite a lot of different performance and memory usage improvements in the last few releases. So let me list the benefits of using SysLogNG in IoT and big data environments again. First of all, it's high performance and reliable log collection. It's a simplified architecture where you can use the same application for system logs and any kind of text data. The resulting data is easier to use due to parsing and reformatting. And it can also lower the resource requirements on the processing side, thanks to the efficient message filtering and routing. If you want to learn more about SysLogNG, the central source of information is syslogng.org. We have the source code of SysLogNG up on GitHub, which also hosts our issue tracking system. We have a mailing list, and if you have question, you can also post it on Jitter. Do you have any questions?
So I don't quite understand how I would log from, for example, from my C code, how would I make sure it ends up like on Elasticsearch? Do I need to do just to log into the normal syslog, or whether?
Yes, no. If you have these all of these small devices, the usual architecture is that your code sends logs to syslog. SysLogNG sends the log message to the central location, and the central syslog server sends it to Elasticsearch. So you don't have to install Elasticsearch client on all of your devices. Yeah, yes? Actually, I don't know. There are the smallest devices are usually a Raspberry Pi and that category. So a barebone Linux system or BSD or whatever. If you have any questions, I will be here in front of the room for a while. And I also have a developer colleague, so if you have more programming side questions, you can also ask him. Thank you.